folks, Steve has had several strokes in the past. He's a godly man and a trooper. And we're going to pray that God keeps him in his hands. So let's go in prayer one more time. Father God, we come to you once again, Father God, and we lift up Steve to you, Father, as he goes through this illness that's going on with him. We pray for your hand upon him, Father God, that you would lift him up and you would, Father God, give a clear vision to the doctors on what's going on with him. We pray for your healing and your healing hand upon him. And we ask this in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen. You know, Satan's trying to throw depression in here today. Satan's trying to say, y'all don't need to be here today. Satan even used the weatherman to convince a lot of people that they don't need to be here because it's going to rain 2 inches of rain and we might get washed off the street. Satan's smart, isn't he? And that's what happens sometimes is we let other people cause fear in our lives. And it happens all the time that, you know, we can hear about a snowstorm coming. In Texas, you don't really see snow very deep, but you can hear about a snowstorm coming and everybody runs to the store. They stock up like they're going to be frozen in for a month. I mean, you can't even get anything off the shelves. Everything's gone. And it snows one day and the next day the sun's out. That's Texas, right? So don't let Satan take your joy out this morning for any reason because God's in control. Amen? This morning I'm going to talk to you about a subject that's going to be about somebody you can relate to. Someone that you know very well, or I hope you know very well, and it's about, Ron, won't you give me that? Let me kind of show them what this is about this morning.
You know, talking about you makes me smile. But every once in a while, I want to talk about me, want to talk about I, want to talk about number one. Oh, my, what I think, what I like, what I know, what I want, what I see. I like talking about you, usually. But occasionally, I want to talk about me.
Everyone knows that song. You know, I could go a little bit further. I could get me a big selfie stick, put it right up here, and, you know, you can go all out. Because this is a world of me, all about me. It just seems to get more and more that way. Some of you that don't know me, my name is Neely Reginald Stewart Jr. It's not Reggie. It is my legal name is Neely Reginald Stewart Jr. after my dad. I'd shorten that because in school I was called Junior up till I got in the sixth grade. And they wouldn't allow me to use that anymore. Said, no, you got to use your legal name. Well, you have to write a name this long. You know, and it takes me longer to write that than it did any of my homework. So I decided to shorten my name to Reggie. And that's what I go by. And a lot of people know me by Reggie. Some people I grew up with still call me Junior. My mom always called me Junior. But they kind of got on board. My dad did. He started calling me Reggie, you know, later in the years. But it made it so much easier for me. And sometimes I'm known as Brother Reggie, Pastor Reggie, you know, and sometimes I'm known as other names. I won't mention those. But people know me because of my work. I own my own company. So I do a lot of work for people. They know me by that. People know me because I love to fish. People know me as a fisherman. Not just for fishing, for fish, but for men too. They know me that way. And that's great to be known that way. And people know me because I pastor this church. You know, I got a lot of friends. My birthday party, I ain't never had a birthday party, 250 people. When I turned 60 years old, I hit the jackpot. I had lots of folks, and that's when you know people actually know who you are, and it's a nice feeling. It feels really good about to have all that going on, and people know you in that way. Y'all have to excuse me. I'm still battling a little cold here. The problem is that's not what I want to be known for. I want to be known as Reggie, the man of God. I want to be known as Reggie, a godly man. Not from all that other stuff, from what God's given to me and who I am. There's a whole difference in who we are when we become a man of God or a godly man. Amen? So, you know, if you're a godly person, then Let that reflect about you. Let God shine through you and show who He's made you to be. Right? So it's okay sometimes to be about you, as long as you're making sure God's out there in front. God comes first. Amen? So sometimes when we talk about that, is we're known for all of the things we do. You know, we have people that in all kinds of walks of life, through church, through organizations, through everything, they're known for that. But do people actually know them as being a godly person? That's the most important thing to me, is being known as a godly person. Out of everything else I've accomplished in life, that means more to me than anything else. And I just began to realize, just through a call recently that made me view the way that I was being viewed for the wrong reasons. A call came to me where someone wanted me to pray for a burden or a problem going on in their life. And of course, I told them, yeah, I'll pray for you. I'll pray with you. Not a problem at all. But have you prayed for yourself? Have you prayed for this problem also? And they said, well, no, I don't want to pray about me. I don't want to pray about my problems. They said, I want you to do it, because you seem to have a better connection with God than I do. A better connection with God. Why is that? Why would somebody think like that? That was the first thing that hit me. Just so y'all know, that if you're a believer and follower of Christ, you have the same connection with God as I have. There's no difference. There's no difference at all. I think the difference that they're referring to that they might see is, I stay connected with God. I don't have to reconnect with God every time something happens in my life. I don't have to reconnect with God every time somebody comes to me with something they need in prayer. I'm already connected. I stay connected 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's the difference. That's where you all should be. You all have the same connection. It's how you use it. Sometimes I say we all make the call, we just don't pick up the phone. We don't know how to dial it. Or we hang up too early. One of those things are going on. If you want that connection, then you have to have that. That's called being filled with the Holy Spirit. Is exactly what that means. It each time that a believer comes into Christ, that's what happens to them. They are filled with the Holy Spirit. I can tell you numerous times, I even know for me, the day I was baptized, not just the day that I accepted Christ, but the day I was baptized, man, that feeling of the Holy Spirit all over you was one of the greatest feelings I ever felt in my life, no matter what happened, what I could compare it to. That was a great feeling. And you know, if you don't feel that you're full of the Holy Spirit, then maybe you just need to empty out some of the things in your life to allow the Holy Spirit more room to move into your life. Because that's what happens. Sometimes we've got blockers there a little bit. D.L. Moody said, I believe firmly that the moment our hearts are emptied of pride and selfishness and ambition and everything that is contrary to God's law, the Holy Spirit will fill every corner of your hearts. But if we are full of pride and conceit and ambition and the world, there is no room for the Spirit of God. We must be emptied before we can be filled. Amen? So do you have a blocker that's keeping the Holy Spirit from completely filling you full of the Spirit? Sure we do. Many of us have that going on. You're going to fall down. The Bible tells us we're going to fall down. But it's the constant staying in sin that blocks God's Holy Spirit from taking hold of your life. And if you're filled with the Holy Spirit, that sin's a whole lot less likely to be in your life. Amen? I've got an example of this right here. If I take this little cup here and I fill it full or half full of water like this, the question would be, how do I get the rest of the air out of the glass? There are all kinds of answers there. I read numerous answers. People came up with some of the craziest stuff. But the one that came up more than anything else was, you got to suck the air out with some kind of vacuum. That's the only way you can get all that out of there. And that was with a lot of people. And to be honest with you, if you sucked all the air out of this glass with a vacuum and it was strong enough, it would actually shatter the glass. Amen? So you can't do it that way. So the easiest way to do it is fill it up. Fill it up. If I don't spill this, all the air is gone. That's how the Holy Spirit works. You're either full or you're half full or you're empty. And you can be anywhere in that. And you see, your victory in your life's not done by just sucking out a little sin here and a little sin there. That's not how you achieve victory in your life. You got to completely get rid of it. You got to get all that out of your life so the Holy Spirit can come into your heart. And it can take you over. And it can lead you in everything you do. You say, man, I don't get that. I don't get that. Sometimes you can see a person where the Holy Spirit is all over them. And that's the person I want to be around. You know, I don't want to beat somebody up with Scripture. I don't want to criticize what they got going on in their life. I don't want to judge them or any of that. But there's some people that I just don't want to be around. And that's a person that's negative. They got all these problems going on in their life, and they can't seek the one that's going to fix it. They want me to pray that into their lives and fix it. They got the same power I got if they're a true believer, true follower of Jesus Christ. Amen? So that's where we fall down. Are we just kind of want part of the Holy Spirit? Do we just want it on Sunday morning when we show up here? Do we just want it when it's convenient for us? That we kind of hide it away because we don't want somebody to know that's going on in our life? Or do we want it all over us? Man, I get excited when I get around someone that truly has the Holy Spirit upon them. I live with somebody like that every day. My wife. I'll be honest with you, I didn't want to be here this morning. I'm sick. I went and fished yesterday. I put that first. And I didn't feel good when I got home last night. Running a fever, I felt terrible. My wife actually brought me something to eat. And as soon as I did that, took a shower, laid down. And I told her, I said, you know, I don't have my sermon ready. I don't want to be here this morning. I need to call somebody to fill in for me today. Because I just don't think I can do this. And then I kept talking to myself. I guess I wasn't talking to her because she didn't answer. And I said, you know, but that wouldn't be right to put this on somebody else at such a short notice. And she looked over at me and she said, well, suck it up, Buttercup. I'm here. That's my wife. Cowboy up. There you go. You know, I've been asked several times, how can you step in front of people and preach God's word without the fear of messing up, making mistakes, or saying something that upsets people? Been there, done that. Still doing it. But I'm not fearful about it because I believe what I bring is what God gave me to bring. I believe God walks right up here with me. He's with me in everything I do and everything I say. Am I going to mess up? Yep. And you know what? I think God allows me to do that. Because you don't learn anything if you don't mess up. You're not trying. Now, I don't want to offend anybody. So I always go back to God's word to make sure I'm not doing anything out of God's word that's going to offend somebody. But if God's word offends somebody, tough. That's the way it is. It's God's word, right? They just got to suck it up, Buttercup, right? I do it all the time. And not in a bad way. It's all out of the Spirit of the Lord. How do I do this? Because God gives me the courage and the strength to do His will and what He's called me to do. He gives me all that. This isn't me. This even being a pastor or preaching at all, out of my norm. Now, I love to talk. That's a gift and a sin, I guess, both. But you know what? He gave me the desire to do this when I really didn't want to do it. This was His will, not mine, because I fought it. Me Many of you probably today are fighting things that God's calling you to do. But when the Holy Spirit overcomes you, you have no choice. I tell everybody this story. I was on a fishing trip with Brother Gary Morgan, a bunch of men, godly men, from Ellis County. We were out in New Mexico, and I'd been doing some devotionals. I was doing the Bass Club devotionals, and man, I was learning a lot. And I'd been doing this now for a couple of years. And somewhere we were talking, and somewhere between New Mexico and Texas, something came over me. And I just began to cry. You know, I couldn't control it. It just overwhelmed me. I had no control over it. And you think that's not embarrassing in front of all these guys? You know, that I can't control what's going on. And nobody said a word. Nobody except the pastor. He turned around and looked at me. And he said, you're going to be a pastor. I said, nope. I think you missed on this one. Boy, was I wrong. It started that day that the Holy Spirit came upon me with what God really wanted me to do. And I know there are people here now that's got that same thing going on with them, that the Holy Spirit is on them and they're being called to do something, but they're sitting here over here on the sideline and say, hey, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. I don't think I can do this. God sends you, then He equips you. You don't have to be equipped to go. God's going to give you what you need. Man, when I first walked in here and I started preaching to these people, I don't know how they put up with me. There you go. It was a learning experience. But you know, the only thing I could show them was my heart. That's it. Because I didn't know what I was doing. I knew what God told me and what He led me to do each Sunday, but I didn't have no idea what really to say. I knew how to put devotionals together. I just made them a little longer. And it seemed to work for a while. But I found the longer and the more I got into God's Word, the more He opened the door of what needed to be said and what He wanted me to do. Some of you, I don't know who it is, but I know there are people here right now have that same thing going on. You may not be being called to be a pastor. You may not be being called to do anything except fellowship, pray with someone else. You may not feel you're being called to be a leader. But every one of you have a job in God's kingdom, and you have a job in God's house. And if that's just to reach out and disciple somebody else and bring them to know the Lord, bring them to church so they can hear God's word. Each one of you have the same exact connection that I have. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all this through Him who gives me strength. I can do all this through Him that gives me strength. But I like the King James Version. It, a lot better. It says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Absolutely. I like that one better. Because that's true. There's nothing that you can't accomplish in your life if you believe God's there with you. If you believe He's going to give you the strength, the wisdom, and the knowledge how to accomplish it. Each one of you have the same connection. You'll find throughout the Bible men who had great courage. Because they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They knew God was with them also. So I think where we get separated here is sometimes we think we're out here doing this stuff on our own, or we're alone, or we're going to wind up serving God, but we're going to do it alone. You're never alone. Never alone at all. Some of the people in the Bible, you've got to think about what they went through and where their courage came from, because there's no other way they would be able to do what they did. No other way at all. John the Baptist. Many of you can relate to that. John was not afraid of being politically incorrect. And apparently he's not sent to make friends or influence people. Because he didn't do any of that. You know, he was pretty straightforward because he spoke the truth of God. That's what gave him the courage. The Holy Spirit was all over him. And he had the courage to speak the truth of God. Turn with me to Luke. Luke chapter 3, begin at verse 7. Yeah, I'm in the right place. Luke chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. We're going to look at what John the Baptist said here. This is pretty straightforward. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers." Boy, that got their attention, didn't it? Who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, "We have Abraham as our father." For I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees. And every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. Golly, he said that right to all these people that were coming out. And some of them felt like they were true followers of God. And they're coming out, and he's right in their face. He even got in Herod's face and said, "Hey, it is unlawful for you to take your brother's wife as your own." He said that to him. Of course, he lost his head for it. But he had the courage to say it because he knew he was saying the truth of God. Amen? So John, he was one of those with courage. You got Daniel. How about Daniel? Daniel, because of his faith, and because of what he believed in, he was thrown into the lion's den with a whole bunch of lions and left overnight. And God sealed the mouths of the lions. Did not let one lion harm him at all. Daniel, because he had the Holy Spirit all over him and he wasn't going backwards. No turning back. Amen? He was going to stay the path that God was leading him, and he wasn't going to let anybody scare him into believing that his faith wasn't good and true. I like these guys. How about the three men that were thrown into the fiery furnace? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Not a hair on their head was singed. In the hottest fire, they said the king heated it twice as hot as it ever was. In fact, a couple of the guards, they died putting them in the fire. It was so hot. But not one hair on their head was singed. You couldn't even smell their clothes burning or anything. Man, did they have courage? They knew what was going to happen. They wouldn't bow down. They wouldn't bow down to the king. And they had courage, man. They're standing with God. And you know what? It's so good that we can relate to people in this book that had that courage. But some people go, "Man, that's just stories." That's God's word. Stories. We don't believe that. Well, you know, King Nebuchadnezzar, he didn't believe it either. He had a problem with it. He didn't believe in their God at all. So we're going to go to Daniel chapter 3, beginning at verse 24. Oops, wrong place. Maybe? Yep. That's where I want to go. I just went to the wrong place. Daniel chapter 3, beginning at verse 24. Had it marked wrong, sorry. This is after the fire was heated up. This is after they've thrown Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into the fiery furnace, and the king's watching all this. And picking up at verse 24, says, "Then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, 'Weren't there three men that were tied up and threw into the fire?' They replied, 'Certainly, your majesty.' He said, 'Look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the fourth looks like a son of God.'" God don't put you in the fire. He gets in there with you. If you're in fire right now, why ain't God in there with you? You're not letting the Holy Spirit get there with you. You've got to have the Holy Spirit on you if you want God in the fire with you. And many of us here today have been in that fire at one time. So why are you blocking out the gift God is trying to give? Because the world, sin, and other things in our lives tend to want, we want to fill with that. We want to fill our hearts with stuff of this world instead of what God has for us. That's what blocks it out. If you have problems going on in your life, then maybe you need to search your heart and say, "Hey, you know, I'm trying really hard, God, but something, some reason I'm not getting that connection." Maybe it's something you're hiding. Maybe it's something you're hiding from everybody in your church. Maybe it's something you're hiding from your family. But if you think you're hiding it from God, you're wrong. God knows what's going on there. He's just waiting on you to tell Him. He's just waiting on you to call to ask to get rid of it. Repent, give it up. He's waiting on you. God not only protects you from the fire, He'll get in there with you. I love that part of that scripture. The first person that comes to mind when I think of a man of courage is David, King David. Most of you probably think of King David too, just as I do, because he did have the courage, because he stood up. And he was the one that stood up against Goliath. And the reason he did that, he was connected with God. He had the Holy Spirit all over him, and he had no fear. I don't know if it was he was just young and dumb because of some things he did, but I'll tell you what, the Holy Spirit was all over him, and he called on God and everything that went on. So even as a young man, he had the Holy Spirit, and he had it working in his life. Let's go to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 4. Verse 4. Right here where we're picking up, this is where the Philistines and the Israelites have, they've lined up on hilltops across from each other with a valley between them, and they're getting ready to do battle. And this is where we're going to pick up the first part. It says, a champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out to the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze weighing 5,000 shekels. On his legs he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, Why do you come out and line up for battle? I am not a Philistine, and you are not the servants of Saul. Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us. Then the Philistine said, this day I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other. On hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. Now Saul was supposed to be connected with God. And the men that were under him, these soldiers, or these men that were going to go into battle, they were supposed to be connected with God. So why were they so fearful? This guy scared them. Of course, he's a big dude. He was a really big dude. Had some really big armor and really big weapons. But these were men of God. Where did they lose that spirit that God was with them? Something in Saul's life was brewing there. And we know that as we continue to read the story. Something in Saul's life was blocking that Holy Spirit from being all over Saul. Otherwise, why did he fear this giant? Now let's pick up at verse 17, chapter 41. This is where David comes on the scene. This is where David, he comes into the picture. Now, David, he was just a young shepherd boy. You know, he really didn't know anything about battle that anyone thought. His brothers didn't even want him getting involved because he just came out to bring them some grain and check on them. That's all he was there for. But then he heard what this Philistine, what this giant said, what Goliath said, and it made him mad because he was connected with God and it irritated him. And he said, why are y'all letting this guy do this? Little shepherd boys questioning these soldiers. Why are you letting this giant scare you? So we're going to pick up there where David comes into the picture. It says, meanwhile, the Philistine with his shield bearer in front of him kept coming closer to David. He looked David over and saw that he was little more than a boy, glowing with health and handsome, and he despised him. He said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. Come here, he said, and I'll give you your flesh to the birds and the wild animals. David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. This very day I will give the carcass of the Philistine army to the birds and the wild animals, and the whole world will know there is a God in Israel. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. As the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward him, toward the battle line to meet him. Reaching into his bag and taking out a stone, he slung it and struck the Philistine on the forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. So David triumphed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone. Without a sword in his hand, he struck down the Philistine and killed him. David ran and stood over him. He took hold of the Philistine's sword and drew it from the sheath. After he killed him, he cut off his head with a sword. When the Philistines saw that their hero was dead, they turned and ran. David! Who gave David all that courage? God Almighty. And Saul, if you back up a little bit, you'll find out that Saul heard David questioning his army and talking to them about, why are you letting this guy do this? And Saul knew he was a young man, but he thought, well, he needs to learn a lesson. He needs to learn something, so he thinks he can do all that. Now, David's telling him, hey, God, I had to do battle. I had to do battle with a bear and a lion. And God gave me the strength, and God gave me the way to take care of that. I grabbed the lion. I cut off his head because of God. So he's telling Saul that, but Saul's thinking, this boy's full of hot air here, but he needs to learn a lesson. Let's let him go out there and be scared off. And, of course, we know Saul gave him all the armor and everything that he needed to go out there and do battle that all his soldiers had. But David goes, man, this stuff's weighing me down. I don't need that. All I need is a sling and these stones. And basically, I don't even need that. All I need is God. David, little bitty David, became a king because of the Holy Spirit that was all over him, because of the courage and strength that God gave him. These are just small examples of people in the Bible that had that courage to do what God called them to do. And the key verse here in this is in verse 45. But I like the part where it said, David ran. He ran to the battle line. He didn't stroll out. He didn't go out there cowed down and scared. He ran out there and said, bring it on. Come on. Let's have it. Little bitty guy gets big guy. I guess that kind of could scare a big guy right there saying, this guy's a nut. The key verse, David said to the Philistine, you come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty. You can go do the same thing. You have the ability to do the same thing, just as I do. If you're going to go up against somebody, go up against them in the name of the Lord Almighty. Use His words. Use what He leads you to do and say. You'll come out a winner every time. Every time. You see, David was a man of God and filled with the Holy Spirit. Even though he was a very young man, he already had it. He got it. That's what we like to say. He's got it. I think that's what's missing with some of us from time to time. We don't got it yet. We don't got it. That's not a good, proper way to say that, is it? But it's true. When you get it, you know it. And God will make sure you know it. Because He's going to start to move you all over the place. He's going to move you into areas that are out of your comfort zone that you don't even want to go. But because you're listening to Him, He's the one making the moves, you're going to do it. Everyone here has that same power available to them that David had. You have the same power David had. That's hard to imagine, isn't it? Can you see yourself up against a giant? You do every day. The giant of government. The giant of businesses. The giants that thrown at you in life. You have them against you every day. Are you winning those battles? Because if you're not, you're blocking. Something's not letting you be filled with the Holy Spirit where God's leading you to do battle. The well-known minister Andrew Murray said it this way, may not a single moment of my life be spent outside the light, love, and joy of God's presence. and not a moment without the entire surrender of myself as a vessel for Him to feel full of His Spirit and His love. Amen. Let God in. Don't just let Him part the way in. Let Him all in. Your life will change. Your life will get so much better. Your battles will be easier because you've used God in the way that He wants you. Get that. In the way He wants you to use Him. He's not telling you to sit over there and do it by yourself. He's saying, call on me every minute of every day, and I'm there for you. I will help you through anything you're going through. But first, you got to get connected. You got to call on Him. Amen? And then the Holy Spirit, golly, it moves us when we think we can't be used by God. It moves us in that moment that we think we're done. God can't use us in any way. We got a past. We got something going on in our past. God can't use us. That's not true. Any of you thinking that, put that away right now. That's not true. Because if you're a true believer and follower of God and you're anointed with the Holy Spirit, you can be used in anything God wants you to be used in. And He will use you. And if you're not being used, get connected. Get connected. Some of you may say, well, I am. I'm in leadership. That's great. But there's more to it. Are you connected every day? Are you using what God gave you every single day? I would say to you today, more than anything, to allow God to use you to accomplish what His will is one of the hardest things for us to do. Because our will is what we want. But we've got to say, hey, God, what is it that You want me to do for You today? And you need to say that every day. And believe that He's got a job for you. Does that work? Works for me. Does it work for you? I can't say that. That's between you and God. But if you do not feel like you're connected in any way with God and the Holy Spirit, then it's time to separate yourself from what's keeping you from being there. Today, get rid of all those things that are holding you back. Everything that's holding you back. Allow God to completely fill you with the Holy Spirit. And stop questioning whether God can use you or if you have the proper connection to do the will of God. Stop questioning that. Because if you call on God, you get connected, and you're anointed with the Holy Spirit, there's no question there at all. You're just going to do it. The connection is made by you. Not me, not your relatives, not anybody else. The connection with God is to be made by you. God made the first move when He hung His Son on the cross. He moved first. It's your turn. So don't just sit there. Get moving. The stronger the walk with God, the stronger the connection with God. Amen? Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for this day. Father, we do thank You for the rain that's always needed. Father God, we pray that You continue to be with us as we move forth with Your church house and Your church works here. Father, we thank You for the favor and the blessings You can continue to pour out here. And Father, we thank You for that on the that You pour out on the church congregation here, Father God, that You'll continue to be with them. Father, I pray this morning that You pour out Your Holy Spirit on everyone. Everyone within the sound of my voice, that You pour out Your Holy Spirit on them, Father God, and You make that connection. And Father God, You start to move them in a way that they can deal with any battle in their life, Father, that they would be the ones that help further Your kingdom. Father, we pray for safety as everyone leaves here. We pray that You look after them in their travels. And Father, we pray that everything we did and said here today was uplifting, glorifying, and pleasing to You. And we ask this in Jesus' holy and precious name. Amen.